This evening we are going to be talking about the evolution of Boko Haram. A lot of us must have heard about that name, Boko Haram. Though the name Boko Haram is not its original name, but we make do with Boko Haram. The original name is it's quite difficult to pronounce. Jamaat al Husana Dawa Wa Jihad, meaning the group of the people of Sunnah for preaching and struggle. That is the name they gave to themselves. But people, because of their ideology, what they do, people refer to them as Boko Haram, and that is the name we have come to know them as. Though one of the leaders some time ago argued the meaning. First of all, what is the meaning of Boko Haram? It's from two words, Boko in Hausa and Haram in Arabic. Boko is, you can say, call it book education in Hausa, and Haram is in Arabic is sin,
forbidden.
Thank you, sir. So it literally translates to mean education, or Western education is forbidden. But one of the leaders had come out some time ago to argue that the meaning is not Western education is forbidden, but Western civilization, not just education. Civilization encompassing education, everything about the West is forbidden. But before we go into a discussion of Boko Haram, I'll introduce you to Nigeria. Nigeria, a lot of us know little about Nigeria, both good and bad. But I don't know the bad, I know the good, because I'm from Nigeria. Okay, well, Nigeria is the largest country in Africa in terms of population, with over 170 million people. It's the largest black country on earth. And the population makes it such that of every five black people, one is a Nigerian. Nigeria is in a landmass about half the size of Queensland, but with 170 million people. And also, it's also the largest economy in Africa. Largest economy in Africa and 26th largest economy in the world. Nigeria was formed in 1914, the amalgamation of the Southern and Northern Protectorate by the British colonial administration. And this Southern and Northern Protectorate, this dichotomy still exists as we speak. The North and the South, that division is still there. And this is more pronounced because most of the North is made up of Muslims and the South predominantly Christians. Then, and this has defined everything, the economy, the politics, and what have you. Then, Nigeria gained independence in 1960, but till 1999, it had intermittent military rule. But since 1998, Nigeria has enjoyed the civilian administration. Then why are we studying Boko Haram? Just a brief about Boko Haram, what the atrocities Boko Haram have committed. Over 800,000 children homeless because of the activities of this sect. 1.6 million people displaced, UNICEF. It has killed about 15,000 people. It uses both conventional and unconventional weapons, from the use of cutlass machetes to even of recent, suicide bombers, and not just suicide bombing, but using kids, girls, as young as 7, 9, girls for bombing, for suicide mission. So that is the kind of set we are looking at this evening. They actually announced themselves to the international community when they bombed the UN building in Abuja. Abuja is the capital of Nigeria, capital city in Nigeria. They bombed the UN building in 2011, August 26, 2011. That was when they announced themselves to the international community. But most of us, I guess, came to know them when they kidnapped the Chibok girls, about 276 girls kidnapped from their secondary school, where in the boarding school, where they were preparing for secondary examination. They were kidnapped, and from then on, we began to have the hashtag, what we call hashtag diplomacy, the bring back our girls campaign that went on. Even Michelle Obama and David Cameron were part of this campaign. A lot of celebrities were part of it. This announced Boko Haram to the world, to everybody. Since then, they have become a major threat, not only to Nigeria, but to the West African sub-region. And this has assumed a more frightening dimension because of their pledged allegiance to Al-Qaeda and the Islamic State. So this shows, and they are by all means trying to show their hatred for the Western civilization and Western institutions. Now, we will look at the evolution of Boko Haram. How did Boko Haram start? Boko Haram started sometime between 1995 and 2002. Now, in 1995, there was a group that was formed in the University of Maiduguri, university in Nigeria, that was a study group. Somehow, the leader of the group left the university to Medina, University of Medina, and the leadership metamorphosed and dropped into the hands of Mohammed Yusuf. Mohammed Yusuf is actually the creator, allow me to use the word, creator of the Boko Haram we know today. He was able to go around Northern Nigeria preaching the message of jihad. Which was based on three key things. Three factors I've identified that have helped Boko Haram to evolve. One is the economic condition in Nigeria, and Northern Nigeria in particular. Two, the is the political situation, leadership situation, and three is religion. But today, because of time, I want us to focus more on the political, which, as we are discussing the political, we will see how the economic and the religious come into play. Now, when Boko Haram started in NS in 2002, and they tried to mobilize the people, mobilize youth who were poor, who were unemployed. Northern Nigeria has 10 million children out of school. A lot of them are Amajiris. Amajiris are students under Islamic scholars, young children that are sent to train under Islamic scholars. And a lot of them are restricted to just this education. They don't attend the secular schools. So we have about 10 million of them out. These people are poor, they live mainly by begging. And this has created a pool of readily available people for any radical to make use of. So it was a ready pool for Mohammed Yusuf to recruit from. So now this hardship was so intense that it is far better for you to live as an insurgent, a terrorist, or whatever you call it, an extremist. It's far better, it's better economically for you than to live as an insurgent, than to live as a normal citizen. So this economic situation created that opportunity. And it's not new. It's not new in that part of the country. It has been there since 1804, when an Islamic scholar called Ibn Afudio carried out an insurgency that created a caliphate referred to as Sokoto Caliphate. Economic situation was also the basis on which he recruited followers for the creation of the caliphate. Also, after then, in 1980s, there was also the Matasin group or Matasin sect led by Mohammed Mawa, who also capitalized on the economic hardship in the north to recruit people into his sect. What I'm trying to establish first of all is that there's an economic situation, and this economic situation makes living a life of an insurgent better than living as a normal citizen. Now, what these sects have tried to do is create a society, create an agrarian, like Boko Haram. Boko Haram created an agrarian society, a community, which the unemployed, they attracted to. They could come, get jobs, or work for the common good of the society, and you get you live well, and you're able to feed, you're able to take care of yourself, you're able to take care of your family. These are the basic, they provided the basic necessity of life that the secular government had failed to provide. So it is rational for, instead of you to die, you take the life of, the they don't see it as an insurgent. They see it as a way out of their economic hardship. So with that, I think I've been able to establish partially how the economic situation has warranted, has helped in evolving in the evolution of not just Boko Haram, but different sects before now. And I think the question that should be coming up in your mind is that how come these economic situations or this economic hardship have not been addressed if we know that this economic situation lead to this kind of insurgency? In 1980, the Matasane insurgency was crushed by the military. Over 10,000 people were killed, and the war was the fight was won, but the radicalization did not stop. It didn't stop because the factors that helped the radicalization process were still in place, and they are still in place. The military is taking care of Boko Haram now, and obviously they are going to succeed. But if the factors that radicalize the youth are not taken care of, it will only take a while. A new sect will come up. Now, outside that, there is the religious angle. In the religious angle, I would want to mention two angles that religion help insurgency. One, scholars or religious leaders can use, with maybe ulterior motive or something, they can use religion as a vehicle to achieve their personal interest. They can use religion, in the name of religion, manipulate people, make them radicals, preach the religion to them, and explain the Bible or in the case of Northern Nigeria, the Quran, in a way that we radicalize these people to achieve their personal goals. That is one way. Then, also, a lot of scholars have argued that religion in itself can be a source of insurgency when it teaches insurgency as a divine cause. When armed struggle, when violence is taught by religion as a divine cause, as what God has asked us to do, then religion becomes a problem, a factor. And in the case of Northern Nigeria, religion has been a key factor because it has been used both ways. It has been used as a source, preaching to these people that it's divine, and it has also been used as a means of manipulating the youth. The division, the line between these two thoughts may be very weak, but the point is, religion is a factor in the creation and the evolution of Boko Haram. A lot of these fighters believe that they are doing the assignment handed over to them by God. And you know what, except those of us that are not religious, those of us that are religious know the effect of our religious leaders on us. And we know how the things of religion can be very sentimental. And if you believe in a cause and you believe in it based on your religion, it is difficult to dissuade you from because this is what, this is part of what has helped the Boko Haram and radicalization in northern Nigeria. Then we'll look at the political factor, which has been there also, just like the economic and religious factor. The political factor has also has always been there, right from Uthman and Fodio. The political factor can be of two, also can be viewed in two ways. Can be viewed as the greed of the ruling political class. The greed of the ruling political class can cause insurgency. And the greed of the aspiring political class can also cause insurgency. Now, how do these two thoughts interplay? One, when the political class has refused to do what they are supposed to do, and they have been entangled in corruption, and have refused to cater for the needs of the people, now the greed of the leader comes into play. Also, the greed of the leader comes into, of the political class, that's the ruling political class, comes into play when the political class have used these insurgents, which you will see shortly, use these insurgents as a tool to achieve their political ambition, which helped, this helped Boko Haram to evolve to what it is today. The political class helped them because they were being used as a tool. But at a point which we are now, the political class could no more control them. And it became what we have today. Then that's the greed of the ruling political class. Then the greed of the aspiring political class. There can be the aspiring political elites who want to rule, who want to be political leaders. They can also use the insurgency to achieve this means, this end. They can use the insurgency as a means to achieve this end. So those are the two political, so that's the greed of the aspiring political elite. So now let's look at how the political elite affected, helped in creating Boko Haram. Or helped, I won't say they helped in creating, they helped in the evolution of Boko Haram. It was not like the politicians created Boko Haram, no. Boko Haram came into existence based on other, was created based on other factors. But now the politicians came into play. Mohammed Yusuf was a charismatic leader. Eloquent, speaks well, and speaks to the need of the people. Mix the economic hardship how to with religion, trying to explain to the people the best way to exit this economic hardship. He preached messages like this economic hardship we have to, if we also overthrow this economic hardship, we have to overthrow the system in place, the political system in place. We have to take over the reins of power. Though even inside Boko Haram, there were divisions of how to go about this, but there was one agreement that the political system had to be overthrown. And this was termed jihad. The political system had to be overthrown for the economy to be better. And people easily bought into it because the political system was not providing for them. And here is a man that is telling you that if we can take over this government, we will make the economy better. And this same man that is telling you this is providing you a job, no matter how small the job is. And he's feeding you. So you have no reason not to buy into his ideas. If he as it were, he does not have the political power yet, yet he's taking good care of you. He's doing what the state cannot do. So you easily think about it that if this man can attain the political power, he'll do far better than these infidels. Call them infidels, they are not, even though they are Muslims, but they are not true Muslims. So you see the interplay of religion and economics, then the politics now come into play. So through this message, Mohammed Yusuf was able to amass a lot of followers. He had a lot of followers. And he had a complex where he catered for the educational need, where he catered for the... He built a community where he had his own organs of government, where he had the judiciary, he had the police. So people were employed to handle this aspect, and they had the funds, and they were taking good care. They were, well, you may not say good, but they were taking care of them. They were taking care of them better than the state would do. So he had a multitude of followers who believed in him. Here comes the politicians. Now there was, I'll spare you the names, but there was, in that state, which is northeastern, Boko Haram is predominantly in three states. Nigeria has 36 states, and Boko Haram is predominantly in three states, in the northeast, just three states. Other states in the northeast, that is where Boko Haram. So you hear Boko Haram has taken over Nigeria. Boko Haram, out of 36 states, Boko Haram is in three states. But they were growing in potentials, they were growing in capacity to take over territory, and they were beginning to do that. Just like in most states, the power, especially in Nigeria, there is the power of incumbency. So for him to take over the reins, for him to win the governorship seat, he needed massive support. And now one of the ways he sought for massive support was through Mohammed Yusuf. He saw Mohammed Yusuf as a charismatic leader with lots of followers, and he needed these followers to vote for him. And he beckoned on him to help. And Mohammed laid down his terms. He wanted the governor to introduce Sharia. So those were the terms. We will help you. I will campaign for you, or preach to my followers to vote for you. But when you become the governor, you implement full Sharia in this state. And that was the agreement. And Mohammed Yusuf mobilized support for the senator. And he finally won the governorship seat. He became the governor of Borno State. Alimodu Sharif is the governor's name. As a senator that became the governor, Alimodu Sharif. He, after winning, there was terms of agreement. He was supposed to introduce the Sharia legal system. He introduced it, but partially. That was not the agreement. And this this arrangement between him, between the governor and Mohammed Yusuf, already caused splits in Boko Haram. They all believed in one cause. This system must be overthrown, and the Islamic legal system must be introduced. While Mohammed Yusuf wanted to go through the existing political system, use Ali Muhammadu Sharif to attain that, a lot of others, led by the present leader of Boko Haram, Shekau, that's his name, that's the face you see on most Boko Haram, that's the present leader. He was one of the leaders. He was assisting Mohammed Yusuf then. Shekau never believed in the soft approach. He believed in the violent approach. Let's take on this government, let's overthrow them, declare jihad on them, take them out, and we take over this state, and from this state we begin to take over other states, and finally we take over Nigeria. But Mohammed Yusuf did not quite follow that method. He wanted a soft approach. And at a point, this caused a splitter, and a faction followed Shekau, went to another city, built their place. They had problems with the indigenes of the place, and police came. Tried to settle the dispute, but after a while, they began to have clashes with police, and that resulted in the clash that killed a lot of them initially. But those that were left returned to this. They returned to Mohammed Yusuf. And Mohammed Yusuf, in an attempt to cater for his more radical followers, and because of the failure of his own method, his own soft approach, became more radical in his messages. And he talked now more about overthrowing the system with violence. And he was arrested severally. But before then, he became more violent in his messages, the governor tried to appease them. He appointed one of Mohammed Yusuf's followers as a commissioner. The commissioner, that's what he calls ministers, as one of his ministers, as one of a cabinet member in charge of religious affairs. It is believed that through this cabinet member, the Boko Haram, Mohammed Yusuf's disciple that was in the cabinet, the state funds were being disbursed to Boko Haram. But what has become obvious is, while the state government or the governor was disbursing this fund, he was thinking he was taking care of his those that helped him achieve his political ambition, but he didn't know that they had another plan. They were busy arming themselves. So it is believed that the first source of funding for the armament of Boko Haram is from the state. So you see how politics played a major role in the creation of an evolution of Boko Haram. Though politicians will tell you, we did not create Boko Haram. True, they didn't. But the Boko Haram we know today, they helped it succeed. Now, at a point when they could not resolve their issues, the governor and Mohammed Yusuf, the clashes started. At a point, Mohammed Yusuf left the country, went to Saudi Arabia, and the deputy governor, when he went on Hajj, met Mohammed Yusuf. Because Mohammed Yusuf was declared wanted in Nigeria, but the deputy governor used his connections and brought him home. He was not arrested, but that didn't stop his violent outburst. Before you know it, the state, he began to attack the state more, and a lot of times he was arrested, granted bail, and one particular incident in 2009, when the police, they were enforcing the wearing of helmet on motorbike. Here we have Boko Haram members coming from a burial ceremony. They were not putting on their helmet and they were arrested. It resulted in a fracas and some of these men were killed. And some Boko Haram members also, the Nigerian security force cracked down on them heavily, using both the police and the Nigerian army, and about 800 of them were killed. And the complex was destroyed, burnt, and a lot of them ran away. A lot of the leaders ran away, but that commissioner, that through whom the finance was disbursed to the sect, was killed. The father-in-law of Mohammed Yusuf, who is believed to be the armed supplier, was killed. And Mohammed Yusuf himself was arrested and later killed outside the judicial, extrajudicially. You see, just like they did in the case of Matasin, if you look at, if we had time, we would have looked at all the sects. You see, these things, they are reoccurring. It's not new. The leader of Matasin was also killed. He was killed in 1980, but the fight continued in 1985. Same, the leader of Boko Haram was killed, but the fight is still on till now. Now, those other leaders, like the very violent Shekau, a lot of them, they fled Nigeria and joined different sects in Algeria, training camps in Mali, Akadar-linked groups. And when they returned, they were now more sophisticated, no more the machete fighting and the hit and run. They were now ready for the state. And that is what we have today. Boko Haram became extremely violent. Initially, it was thought that they were revenging the death of their leaders. Before you know it, they started taking over territories. Before you know it, they started suicide bombings. Before you know it, they kidnapped girls, children from school. They started burning schools. They started using kids as suicide bombers. So much atrocities. But again, this would have been taken care of. Just like Obama always said, you downgrade, negotiate. I believe Boko Haram could have been downgraded, because at a point, what was now obvious was that the military could not match them. It's not that the military actually could not match them, but the corruption in the in the system prevented the military from acting effectively. So much funds allocated, budgeted to defense, but ending up in private pockets. So they lack the weapons. They lack the weapons to handle these people. Then again, there, some other factors came into play. When they go after them, they run into neighboring countries. And Nigeria, and the neighboring countries were not very cooperative then, because they didn't see Boko Haram as their problem. They saw it as a Nigerian domestic problem, which Obama has always said. Though Obama goes a little further, it's a domestic problem, but at best, a regional problem. So that was how Boko Haram began to grow. And when it was obvious that the military were no match, they started taking over territories, started expanding, and another factor that helped them to grow rapidly was sympathy from northern elites. This is how it happened. Remember I told you that Nigerian politics has remained divided in that southern, northern protectorate. Christians versus Muslims. Then you now have some people in between that now decide, just like in the United States, you have undecided voters. Yeah. So you have the northern, the core north vote for northerners, the core south vote for southerners. Then you find some people in between who you now try to convince to either vote for the north or vote for. So this was like, as it played with religions, it played with religion. Muslim, Christians, then you have the not too fanatical Muslims, not too fanatical Christians who are in between. They don't mind, depending on what you present, they vote for you. This has always defined Nigerian politics. And after rule by the North for so many years, there was an unconstitutional, out of the constitution, it's not in the constitution, there was an arrangement that there should be rotational presidency. What do you mean by rotational presidency? Nigeria was zoned into six. You have the north, northeast, north central, and northwest. You have the south, east, southwest, and south south. Now it was zoned into six. Now the whole idea, it's like a gentleman agreement that when the northeast produce the president, so the president is coming from the north. The south somewhere will produce the vice, and after the terms, you rotate it. Maybe the north, if the south produce the vice president, the southwest will now produce the president, and no more the northeast, the northwest will now produce the vice president. So there's an arrangement of sort, and in 1999, a Southwesterner became president. And a politician from the North became the vice. After 8 years, in 2007, a new president came in from the North. And he was followed, the vice was a South from South, South South. Now, 3 years into his presidency, he died. And there is, the arrangement is unconstitutional. It's just a gentleman agreement. But in the constitution, it is clearly stated that when the president dies, the vice takes over. Now, there was this hue and cry that how can the South just finished the attempts. How can the South come back to power? But somehow, with the intervention of the National Assembly, the Vice President took over the reins of power. So it was like the South was running on the northern time. And a lot of northern politicians were not happy about this. A lot of them even threatened that they were going to take they were going to make Nigeria ungovernable for the southern president, who is Goodluck Jonathan. These were the things that affected some of these affected the president's ability to perform, plus his personal indecisiveness in issues. So what I tried to establish here is that politics has been a major factor in the evolution of Boko Haram. Religion is a factor, economics is a factor, but politics is very key. It has been politics. Though the Boko Haram did not start as a political group per se, but with the politicians involving in it, also even the inability of President Goodluck Jonathan to downgrade them as early as possible, all these are political issues. And all these have helped the evolution of Boko Haram. My presentation will be incomplete if I don't have my own opinion of how Boko Haram, the issue of Boko Haram, can be taken care of. A lot of people have advocated military violent crackdown. A lot of others are on the opposite side have advocated negotiation with them. But I would want to take somewhere in between. I believe that Boko Haram at a point believed that they were more powerful than the Nigerian state. So the Nigerian state must prove to Boko Haram members that the state is much more powerful, first of all. And that is true military means. But just like the case of Matasin, after winning the war, the Nigerian state thought that the issue of insurgency was over. It must not stop there. Downgrade them. Downgrade them in a way that you bring them to the negotiation table. They have legitimate grievances. Are they suffering economically? Yes. Are the politicians corrupt? Yes. Bring them to the negotiation table. Explain after you have downgraded them. Because right now, at the point they were in, when the President Goodluck Jonathan was requesting for negotiation, there was no way they could come to the negotiation table because they felt more powerful than the Nigerian state. And the president said he was going to grant them amnesty. And they replied the president that they were the ones to grant the president amnesty. So it builds on the Nigerian state to downgrade them, deal with them to a level that they will know that the Nigerian state is much more powerful. And after downgrading them, bring them to the negotiation table, they present a clear economic roadmap to help this people and to help the Nigerian state. And I think with that, we will not have a reoccurrence. But if the military takes them out and it ends that way, and the economic factor remains, the political factor remains, and the religious motivation remains, a worse set will come.